Hello, 65 people. We are a band called the Martians, and this is Greyfriars Twisted Tales. Do we have any actors in the room? You ever had that dream where you do a play you haven't done for 2 years and you've forgotten all the lines? That's us. Now some history.
In the beginning, nothing happened. Nothing. Nothing at all. Then Mel Gibson and Robert the Bruce saved us. Then nothing happened again. Then we invented whiskey. And there was fighting. Our recollection of events is somewhat hazy. Then in Germany, somebody nailed something to something. Somewhere. And there was much more fighting. Until the 1500s, everyone in Scotland was poor, ugly, and stupid. Then in Europe, the Renaissance happened, and pretty people started to make clever things. The winds of change were blowing. Unfortunately, Scotland was Roman Catholic at the time, and Roman Catholics don't really do change.
This is how you worship God. The songs he likes, these are the sweets he likes it when you're overawed. These are the words to use, these are the sounds to choose. This is how you should pray, pray this way every day. Other ways of playing are wrong. You'll feel his wrath if you stray from the path that we've outlined to you in this song.
The word of the Pope is infallible,
infallible.
The word of the Pope is
indefatigable.
The Pope is incorruptible.
Incorruptible.
The Pope is indestructible.
Are you sure that's Captain Scott?
Okay. Always getting them mixed up. What's it doing, Precious?
Oh, I'm trying to learn how to read.
Well, come to one of our universities. We'll teach you how to read.
No, no, I'll teach myself.
You can't teach yourself. You won't know how to interpret it.
I can learn.
No! It's the word of God. Look, only the Pope knows how you interpret that.
This is how he likes things said.
In Latin.
This is how he likes you clad.
In Saturn. Salvation.
But if you do not believe.
Damnation.
If you've been bad,
there's no need to feel sad. Just indulge us and we'll do the rest.
I think I disagree with your philosophy. I think change is for the best.
People believe that Martin Luther was constipated. We, however, believe he was just experiencing the birth pangs of the Reformation. John Knox, however, who brought Presbyterianism to Scotland, might as well have been.
Fire and brimstone, gnashing of teeth, bonny hot pokers, thrust up faith, eternal suffering, torture as well, you choose the wrong side, now you're going to hell.
In 1560, Presbyterianism was established in Scotland, and we rid ourselves of monasteries and of bishops. The Franciscan monks of the Greyfriars were forced to abandon their abbey gardens, and Edinburgh Town Council seized the land for use as a graveyard. And they would have great need of it, because the Scots were free to interpret the word of God as they saw fit, which meant much more fighting.
There's a valley on the hill on the southwest side of a town a mile long and a quarter wide. They dumped all the bodies that they could then say, till it wasn't a valley anymore. Town had got no longer, got no wider. The population exploded and said, death count had just grew and grew. They didn't know what else to do anymore. People got diseases from the feces on the streets. The disease increasing ceaselessly for worms to eat. Worms ate all they could, but the bodies and the wood wouldn't turn the valley anymore. So they brought more earth from the outside, then shoved it in the valley and filled the valley in. The whale got sick, the sick got dead, the plague came back, so the council said. But it won't be a valley anymore, anymore, anymore. No, it won't be a valley anymore, 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 anymore. No, it won't be a valley anymore, anymore, anymore.
In the cosmos, and a crap and long trip home. Heath Ledger, the Joker, heaven. Heath Ledger, the cowboy, hell. Michael Jackson, zombie. Patrick Swayze, goosey. To wander in the underground for eternity, seeking other ghosts to help him do things like moving pennies. And he will seek out his ex-girlfriend and make sexy pottery.
John Gray, Derry to Greyfriars Kirkyard. He was a police constable.
But you said I could play a shepherd!
You know how interesting gets. We're doing the Disney version, okay? Anyway, you're a sheep and sheep can't talk. Bat for me, brother.
You can't count the sheep, get strong.
Hey, Bobby! Away John Gray, oh my God almighty, John Gray, I have waited for so long, and now the moment has finally arrived. Just give me a minute, John. Happy birthday, John!
Oh, thank you.
You're fired. You heard me, John. You was 51 years old today, and the sheep's is laughing at you, John. They're laughing at you with their weird little eyes. I've seen it. And so, John, I have taken the executive decision to call in the assistance of a young, nubile, musky-scented young shepherd who strikes fear into the hearts of the sheep and totally floats my boat, John. So, it is time for you, John, and your third traveling terrier to hit the tracks. Get out of my sight, John.
Have you no heart?
A heart? No, John, I don't have a heart. But then again, I never had a little dog like Bobby. Don't teach me the true meaning of love. Oh my God!
She was horrible!
Aye, that she was. And there's many more like her in Edinburgh.
Edinburgh?
Aye, Edinburgh's full of horrible people. But don't you worry about that. It's a beautiful city, and I want to see it once more before I die. Aye, die. Everybody dies. But don't you worry about that, do. Come here, hop on in the car. Horse, we need a horse as well.
Horse, Derek.
Hey, horse.
Thank you.
the monks of the Greyfriars, where, with no more nor save the sullen-faced men hired to dig his grave, and the minister who performed the service, John Grey, was laid to rest.
Speaking like that anymore. In the 17 and 1800s,
the body snatching period,
the golden age of Scottish medicine, thank you, Houston. Some people made their money by digging up the freshly interred corpses and selling them to the anatomists for profit. You could get anything up to £15 for a fresh corpse, a fortune in those days.
A fortune nowadays, I'll get a pint up the stair.
But when it comes to talking about the most famous of all body snatchers, there is, of course, some question as to whether or not they were truly grave robbers at all. And the truth of the matter? Well, therein lies a twisted tale.
Horse! 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 Horse!
Do you wear glasses, eh? Derek's a burlesque performer. He's going to Club Noir tonight. I'm very lucky to have him. The truth about William's Burke and Hare cannot be ratified. For when one of them told the truth,
the other one always lied.
Which was not a prayer, so close were they alive.
Swearing blind that they each spoke truth when one of them always lied. Enlightened was this capital, proud Athens of the North. First David Hume, then Adam Smith had from her loins sprung forth. But ancient superstitions were to halt old Reeky's stride, for cutting up bodies after death was more than a bit decried.
How are we supposed to learn a thing about bodies and how they work? We pay to cure plague of pox.
Said Mr. Monroe to Burke.
Monroe being an anatomist of Edinburgh fame.
And Mr. Burke being the type of man who loved quick ways to gain.
It said Burke sat in Greyfriars as souls were laid to rest, and squinting in the sunlight thought about how you'd do it best.
First with care of the topsoil,
for it would have to be replaced.
And then to dig some 8 feet down, you'd need 3 men at least.
At last, abandoning his plan, William Burke went home.
I'm going home.
But to the detriment of Edinburgh, his Helen wasn't alone.
William Eyre's wife Margaret ran a lodge in Tanner's Close. She had a husband, Mr. Log, but he was now a ghost.
Thank you.
No, he didn't.
The Hares brought Burke and Helen to Log's lodgings to reside. And here, the gals noticed when one spoke truth,
the other one always lied.
It was at this time in Tanner's, near the westport of the town, that Donald, Hare's old tenant, died, owing Hare £4.
Now, £4 then is not £4 now. It's a sum you would sorely miss. How far would you go to get it back, just get a load of dust?
They opened Donald's coffin and replaced the husk with bark.
Woof!
And took the body through the seams under the cover of dark.
They sought Professor Munro, but instead found Dr. Knox, who asked no questions, gave
£7.
10 shillings for the corpse.
A nut.
Another tenant, Joseph, a miller by his trade, came down with something nasty. And as in his bed he lay, Burke and Hare decided that
poor Joseph, he's in pain.
And they hatched this brand of murder that was to earn them lasting fame.
Have a drink, Joseph. Happy birthday, Joseph.
Have another drink, Joseph.
You've only had two so far. Here, Joseph, have some PCP to know something.
That's funny.
Don't call me that. I kill people.
Oh, you do now.
No, I don't.
It's funny because it's life.
Dr. Knox was overjoyed. He welcomed them with glee. This time he gave them
a really stunking fee. And then again, no questions but the origin of the corpse, and said,
I'll gladly pay for more if you have them on a sword.
We love this way of killing, because it didn't leave a mark.
And it meant no filling coffins with twigs or bits of bark.
Woof.
They wouldn't have to prowl around or lie in shadows lurking. They'd do their murdering at home and call their practice
Birking!
Harry, surely.
No, it's definitely Birking we checked.
Emboldened by their powers, William's Burke and Hare went nuts. They killed prominent townsfolk, prostitutes, and the house. They took a phone call from two policemen, earned themselves £10. They killed and killed for months on end. Their evil knew no bounds. But one night, shouts were heard from Tanos.
Manda, thanks the police!
And lodgers found a body in the room that they had leased.
They ran to fetch assistance. On return, the corpse was gone, carried through the cow gate in a tea chest before the door.
Jesus!
Then an unnamed source led the police to the lab of Dr. Knox, anatomist, and there upon the slab lay the missing body.
And they knew that they had found an answer to the many disappearances around town. Now think back to the start of this. The truth that we supplied, that
when one of us told the truth,
the other one always lied.
Their testimonies ranged from the surreal to the sublime, to the utterly ridiculous excuses for these crimes.
I actually just kind of found the bodies all kind of lying there.
Look, it's called physiology, and it could do with a lot of advancing.
It's what the angel told me I had to do.
I read it once in a Shakespeare.
It's called Spider Baby. It's the brain of
long term, I've probably saved more lives than I've ever taken.
If you were to ask Mr. Burke if this was all his idea from the very word go, he would reply, no.
What?
Nothing.
Don't worry, I haven't implicated you in any sort of a way.
I kill people.
No, you don't.
Yeah, I do. I kill lots of people.
On the 28th of January 1829, Burke stood at the gallows with two confessions signed.
Conflicting ones as well, but 16 murders I admitted.
and though involved in every single one here was acquitted.
Knox was found innocent of killing anyone. It's thought that he knew more than most about what the men had done.
And with a jeering crowd of 80,000, Buck was hung.
Burn him!
Buck here too!
And Knox!
They shouted as he swung.
And when his soul had parted, Burke's body was cut down. And fitting for this monster, the council of the town
gave his corpse to one Monroe to dissect publicly. Crowds of thousands waited hours, patient days to see.
Now, popular myth holds that in answer for his crimes, a mob threw Willie Hare into a vat of burning lime.
Whoa! It burns!
It's lime to do that. It's thought he died in London.
Not London!
Begging blind and quite insane.
Oh, well, that'll be grand then.
Margaret Hare and Helen, though, were never seen again.
Famous the world over, William Burke, William Hare. Up there with the best of murderers, this scheming pair. Kings of all brave robbers, but they never robbed the grave.
If only they had never met, so many would have been saved.
Sticking with the graveyard of dead dogs, we wrote a musical a couple of years ago that made us rich for 2 months. And it was also set in Greyfriars with zombies and dogs. Here's a song from The Sundown. It's about a dead dog. It's very sad and it's very beautiful.
No, sir, John, the song is crappy. For a month we had to listen to it. Listen, I'm not being funny or anything, John. It's just, maybe once here. About the dead dog, nobody cares about the dog, nobody cares about you. In fact, I asked the boys earlier, none of us actually really like you.
Sorry.
So anyway, listen, Derek and I, for the past year, we've been doing night classes in mediumship.
Right.
I'm with Derek.
Yes.
And it's been going quite well. We've got our HND now as mediums. So I thought it might be quite good if we did any seance.
Wait a minute, you can't just seance them.
No, listen, it's going to be really, really good.
It's
going to be cracking. So, ladies and gentlemen, for your entertainment now, Derek and I are going to attempt to channel the spirits of some of the great inventors of our nation.
Just for Halloween?
Just for Halloween. Okay. In the Ouija.
In the Ouija?
In the Ouija.
Ouija. Ouija.
Like a Ouija board.
Okay.
You see?
I won't joke him just for tonight.
Okay. This feels like there might be a lot of lyrics. Are you sure this is a good idea?
Let's try it.
Okay.
Though Scotland was the poorest of the Western nations, she contributed so many innovations. Sons of Scotland, dead and gone, stand up and tell us what you've done.
I really don't think this is a good idea. There's something very strange happening.
Oh, this isn't good.
Oh, I was alive. My name was Joseph Black, professor of anatomy and chemist back in Glasgow in 1756. I'm forefather of thermodynamics.
And I'm Joseph Lister, and without these brains, developments in surgery would be in vain, cause most of yous would have died of infection. My antiseptics offered huge protection.
And I'm Charles McIntosh, you've heard my name. Not a famous architect has tried the same. My invention's still used far and wide. A waterproof coat that keeps the whole world dry.
You want to be Alexander Graham Bell? You want to phone a friend and get him to tell you what I invented when I was alive? Without my telephone, how long would you survive?
Guys, I really must confess, I don't think this is a very good idea at all. I don't think Chandler Experience is going to be.
You've seen my statues, there are quite a lot. Before I was a stone, I did some things of note. The first historic novel was a thing I wrote.
And I'm John Crofton, I cured TB. And I'm James Lind, I cured scurvy.
I'm Alexander Fleming, I invented penicillin.
James Clerk Maxwell, electromagnetism.
The speedometer tells you how fast you're going.
And I'm James Braid, look into my eyes. I was the very first to ever hypnotize.
Here's all a bloke and I'm as big as a hornbill. I invented cigarettes, but don't send me a bill.
Don't you dare to my hair to me. Without my heat, is with the Huff TV.
Dilithium crystals, the power systems go, and you hear any more stuff, this is going to be over.
That was serious. How
did you
spoil the big finish. 1, 2, 3.
Postage stamps, the bank of England, the telegraph, the telephone, the television too, the US Navy, Logan and Oaks, Marmalade and Neptune, the microwave, the fax machine and golf to name a few. We invented anesthetics, radar, plastic bridges, Halloween and paraffin and Bakelite as well. Whiskey, economics, bicycles and iron bridges.
Horsepower!
Pens!
And the Kelvin scale! Okay, we didn't invent the wheel, the tires that go around it. The first to get it right, from imitating planets to inventive innovators, global common knowledge that a Scotsman's mind is right.
Thank you.
The new Sergeant Major, sir.
You wrote to them?
I think we should listen to them, darling, sir.
Wanted for a nation of adorable soldiers. One Sergeant Major.
Adorable, that's debatable. What about the Scots?
If you want this choice position, have a cheery disposition.
Now, soldier, I don't think...
Not too loud. We'll smoke, play games, and smoke.
That's the part I put in.
Never be cross or cruel. Keep us stocked on hand grenades and fuel. Love us like a son or daughter, and never smell of
toilet water. I put that in too.
If you won't scold and dominate us, we will never give you cause to hate us. We won't hide your ammo clip so you can't fire. Put bombs under your bed or landmines under tyres. Hurry, sir. Many thanks, sincerely. And please bring us tanks.
In every war that's to be won, there is an element of fun. You find the fun, and poof, the war's a game.
And every bridge you try to take becomes a piece of cake that you can eat while they took on defeat. And one shot between the eyeballs makes the Nazi go down. Just one shot between the eyeballs makes the Nazi go down in a most delightful way. German submachine gun nest has very little time to rest while mowing down a field full of brave boys. But if you paddle drop behind and leave a live grenade inside, with just one blast, you'd clear away.
Shot between the eyeballs makes the Nazi go down. Nazi go down. Nazi go down. Just one shot between the eyeballs makes the Nazi go down. In the most delightful, in the most delightful, in the most delightful way.
Being a soldier's not a drag.
Being a soldier's not a drag.
With a spoonful of sugar in a carpet bag.
British Army getting itself into shape, fit to combat the Nazis. Our attention's turned to the Allies. Unfortunately, our allies are the French.
On each day to the steps of St. Paul's, a little old French woman comes. In her own special way to the people she calls, by the French resistance guns. By the French resistance guns, what she says, and you'll be glad if you do, because every Nazi that the French do kill is one less Nazi coming for you.
Save the French, tuppence I beg, tuppence, tuppence, tuppence I beg. Save the French, tuppence I beg, tuppence, tuppence, tuppence I beg.
All around the cathedral, the piles of munitions add up and prepare to be shipped. Although you can't see it, they swear they are fighting, but please be better equipped. Oh, we don't think that they are. We'd best give them something. They've travelled this far.
Tuppence, 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 tuppence I beg. Now that the second
all dodging and strifing, machine guns and stuff. But then again, our brings them death from above. Bomb Germany, bomb Germany, bomb Berlin. If I see a shipyard, I'm gonna swoop in. My bonds with some pride when our plans, incendiary for fuel dumps, dancing for dams, up where the clouds are all billowed and curled, between pavement and sky is a Lancaster's world. Bomb Germany, bomb Germany. Bomb, bomb, Berlin.
1945. The Allied assault had driven the Nazi war machine back towards the city which had spawned it. Air raids were cancelled, and so I took my chance to fly in and survey Berlin firsthand. There was one more person who needed my help.
My vault was calm, well ordered, exemplary. Then came this pattern with chaos in her wake. And now my life's ambitions go in one fell blow. It's quite the bitter pill to take.
Oh, come along now, Adolf. Cyanide is a bitter pill for anyone to take. I can help.
How?
A spoonful of sugar, that is all it takes. It changes lethal toxins into tea and cakes.
This is Nazi German way. This is British weakness.
Come along now, Adolf. Eva's already taken hers.
Rum punch flavor.
Eva?
Come, comrade. We must break down this door.
Yes, let us share all the work out equally between all of us.
I think that's the Russian sitter.
The spoonful of the sugar helps the medicine run out.
In the most delightful way.
Farewell. I will take the cyanide pill. Once I get over here.
I know what you're thinking. You're thinking Hitler didn't like cyanide. Hitler shot himself. No. Close your mouth, Hitler. We are not a codfish.
Enough, Wench.
Sorry.
You are an extra.
There's a picture in my email, sent by some random female. Looks like it's probably a fake. But there's a video on YouTube, well, the quality's not that good. Cynics say it's probably just a drake. I've heard so many rumors that you are a dream this year, but I know that when you are ready, you'll appear messy. Believe you. Though they say you were an elephant swimming, I know you are a pleasure so living in Scotland. I know that the stories are true, and though I've never seen you,
drifting by. Just a drowning man. I've heard so many people say that someone made you up, but you can't prove a negative without you. I give up.
They say, I believe in you. Well, they say you were an elephant sweating. I know you are a pleasant soul living.
There's nothing written on them at all, they're just white, but we're still charging a fiver. There's lots of good tracks on them. Here's how it works. We'll be at the back with the CDs, bring fivers. This is the play out. We'd like you to join in. It's dead easy. It just goes Nessie, 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 ad nauseam. We're the Martians. Here we go. Ha!
Nessie, 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 Nessie